Hi everybody. Today we will speak about applied eye anatomy clinical tips. This video presentation will discuss important clinical tips of applied eye anatomy. Understanding the eye anatomy and its clinical importance will help us in management of various eye diseases. Pony orbit. The orbital floor is the commonest site for orbital wall fracture, followed by the medial wall. Both floor and medial wall are formed of thin bones. In the floor, it is formed mainly of maxillary bone, and in the medial wall, it is formed mainly of sigmoid bone. The main cause of orbital floor and medial wall fracture is blowout fracture. Clinically, floor fracture is manifested by inosinus, which is the recession of the globe backwards in the orbital cavity. Also, it is manifested by diplopia, which is double vision. Here, the diplopia is vertical diplopia due to entrapment of inferior rectus muscle or injury of the inferior rectus muscle. As regards medial wall fracture, it's manifested also by inosinus, also by diplopia, which here is horizontal diplopia due to entrapment or injury to the medial rectus muscle, and also manifested by orbital emphysema, which is caused by passage of air to orbital soft tissue. Another important topic in orbital disease, which is the differentiation between whether the lesion is intraconal or extraconal. To answer this question, we should know the anatomy of the orbit. The orbit is formed mainly of two cavities. The intraconal cavity, which is pyramidal space limited by the extraocular muscles and located behind the globe. While the extraconal space, it is the space between the extraocular muscles and the bony orbit. Here is the intracone and here is the extraconal space. Intraconal lesion manifested mainly by proptosis, which is axial proptosis caused by full protrusion of the eyeball. It is common manifestation of lesions inside the orbital core. Like this patient, we will notice that this eye is full protruded and this eye is normal. Extraconal lesion. Extraconal lesion usually causes non-axial proptosis, what is called orbital dystopia. Non-axial protrusion of the eyeball caused by any lesion outside the cone, which causes displacement of the globe in eccentric or vertical plane. It is a common manifestation of lesions outside the orbital cone like this patient. Carotid cavernous fistula. Before we describe this disease, we should know the anatomy. Internal carotid artery passes through the cavernous sinus, which drains the venous blood from the eye. So, in carotid cavernous fistula, there is abnormal communication between the carotid artery and the cavernous sinus, so arterial blood will pass to the venous blood in the cavernous sinus and limit the drainage of the venous blood from the eye, causes eye congestion and proptosis. This communication is called a carotid cavernous fistula. Lacrimal gland. Lacrimal gland secretes the watery layer of the tear film. It is located in the upper outer part of the orbital roof. So, any disease affecting the lacrimal gland will affect its secretion, as in cases of Sjögren's syndrome, which is autoimmune inflammatory disease affecting lacrimal and salivary gland. This disease of the lacrimal gland will lead to decrease in its secretions and causes severe dry eye and causes what is called keratoconjunctivitis secca. Lacrimal gland ducts open in the superior fornix in the superior temporal part of the conjunctiva. These ducts drain secretions from the lacrimal gland to the conjunctiva. So any damage to these excretory ducts in the superior conjunctiva will lead to severe dry eye. This occurs in cases of chronic conjunctivitis with keratinization, as in cases of ocular cicatricial pemphigoid. Lacrimal drainage system. Lacrimal drainage system drains tears from the eye to the nose. So, a buffer can be defined as decreased drainage of tears caused by any disease affecting the lacrimal drainage system. Any obstruction on this lacrimal drainage system will lead to a regurg of tears to the conjunctival fornix, as in cases of chronic dacrocystitis. Levator palpebrae subbiosis. All of us know the anatomy of levator muscle, which arises from lesser wing of sphenoid and inserted into the tarsus of the eyelid. So, ptosis, which is defined by drooping of the upper eyelid, can be caused to any lesion in the muscle or any affection of its nerve sublime. So, ptosis can be due to muscle problem, as in cases of congenital ptosis, or a problem in amniosis of the muscle, as in old age ptosis, or what's called amniotic ptosis, or due to cerebral nerve palsy, which is the main nerve supply of the levator muscle, and causes complete ptosis. Molar muscles. Molar muscle, which is also called subiotarsal muscle, is a small muscle arises from the levator muscle and inserted into the tarsus. Its main function is elevation of the upper eyelid like levator, and it is supplied by sympathetic innervation. So, in cases of sympathetic overactivity, as in cases of thyroid eye disease, lid retraction will occur due to overactivity. While in sympathetic hyperactivity, like in Horner syndrome, ptosis will occur. Third nerve or oculomotor nerve is divided into two divisions. Superior division supplies the superior rectus and levator palpebrae subiosus muscle, while inferior division supplies the medial rectus, inferior oblique, and motor to ciliary ganglion. So, third nerve palsy can be described into two types, complete and partial. Complete third nerve palsy clinically characterized by exotropia due to paralysis of medial rectus and hypotropia due to paralysis of the superior rectus with ptosis and medrises like this photo. While partial third nerve palsy, it is variable degree of ductal limitation of the affected extraocular muscle with variable degree of ptosis plus minus pupillary dysfunction. One of the important issues we should know in third nerve palsy, whether it is a medical third nerve palsy or surgical third nerve palsy. It is very important for treatment. Medical third nerve palsy, pupillary fibers occupy the peripheral location, so it is not affected in cases of ischemic neuropathy, which is the main cause of medical third nerve palsy, so pupil is spared. And here the pupil function is not affected. While in surgical third nerve palsy, which caused mainly by any compressive neuropathy, as in cases of aneurysm, it will compress the pupillary fibers, which occupy the peripheral location and causes third nerve palsy. So we can differentiate between medical and surgical third nerve palsy by the pupillary function. Trochlear nerve. It supplies mainly the superior oblique muscle, which one of its functions is depression of the globe. So, in the trochlear nerve palsy, weakness or paralysis of the superior oblique muscle will cause hypertrophia with head tilt down and to the opposite side. Abducens nerve. Abducens nerve supplies the lateral rectus muscle, which main function is abduction of the globe. So, in cases of sixth nerve palsy, weakness or paralysis of lateral rectus will occur, leading to esotropia and limited abduction like this photo. Eyelids. One of the important tips of the applied eye anatomy is the gray line anatomy. Gray line anatomy is an eyelid margin projection of orbicularis muscle known as reolar muscle. It is present in the middle of the lid margin. The importance of the gray line is that it is an important landmark in the repair of laceration involving the lid margin. Mainly by suturing any of lid margin laceration at this site to anatomical alignment of the eyelid margin. Mabubian glands are exocrine glands along the rim of the lid margin inside the tarsal blade. They are glands located parallel to each other inside the tarsal blade, and its main function is secreting the oily layer of the tear film, which is the outer layer of the tear film. Mabubian gland inflammation or blockage will cause chalazion, which is chronic lipogranulomatous inflammation of meibomian glands. Also, meibomian gland dysfunction, as in cases of meibomionitis, will lead to posterior blepharitis and what is called dry eye syndrome. These glands, they are sebaceous glands located on the margin of the eyelid. The gland related mainly to hair follicles of the eyelashes. Any bacterial infection of this gland will lead to acute subarachnoid inflammation and form what is called sty. Very important to know the anatomy of the conjunctiva. Conjunctiva is formed of uncatenized stratified squamous epithelium. Goblet cells are present within the stratified epithelium. Goblet cells secrete mucous layers of the tear film, which is important for conjunctival lubrication. So, any keratinization of the conjunctiva, as in dry eye and chronic ocular inflammation and the cicatrizing conjunctivitis, will lead to destruction of goblet cells and severe dry eye will occur. So, a healthy conjunctiva is important for normal tear film and avoidance of dry eye. Another important topic in conjunctiva, follicle or papillae. Follicle are lymphoid hyperplasia, white or grayish elevation in the tarsus conjunctiva, caused mainly by viral chlamydial infection and the toxic effect of drugs. While papillae are fibrovascular elevations with central fibrovascular core. They are flat-topped elevation in the tarsus conjunctiva caused by allergic and bacterial effect. Cornea. The epithelium of the cornea is formed of stratified squamous non-keratinized epithelium and formed of five layers. The epithelial cells are fast-growing and easily generated cells, kept moist with tears. Any irregularity or edema of the corneal epithelium disrupts the smoothness of the air-tear film interface. So, in cases of corneal ulcer, rapid regeneration usually occur. Dry eye also causes minute erosion called punctate epithelial erosion. We previously said that any interference with the tear film will affect the health integrity of the corneal epithelium. Also, any irregularity or edema of the corneal epithelium disrupts the smoothness of the corneal tear film interface, as in cases of severe corneal edema. Corneal stroma is formed of regularly arranged collagen fibers along with sparsely distributed interconnected keratocytes. Collagen fibers are parallel and are super imbued. The corneal stroma consists of 200 layers of mainly type 1 of collagen fibers. So, a disease which is called keratoconus, it is a disorder of the eye which results in progressive thinning of the cornea. It is mainly caused by weakening of the collagen fibers forming the corneal stroma, by disruption of the regular arrangement of the collagen layers and collagen fiber tissue. This will lead to dehiscence of the collagen fibers and weakening and corneal protrusion, or what's called keratoconus. As regards corneal endothelium is a cubital monolayer of cells. They are responsible for regulating fluid and solutions transport between the aqueous and corneal stromal compartments. So, endothelium has two functions, barrier function and bump function, which are important for maintenance of corneal clarity. Corneal endothelial dysfunction caused mainly by endothelial injury. This will affect its bump function and barrier function, and this lead to corneal edema. It is mainly caused by surgery or due to hereditary test of like hooks in ciliated corneal dystrophy and the causes corneal edema by its variable degrees. The important topic in corneal anatomy is corneal anatomy and keratoblasty. Keratoblasty is formed of two types, mainly as regards corneal layers. Penetrating keratoblasty, or what's called PKP, it is full thickness resection of the patient's cornea followed by placement of a full thickness donor corneal graft. All layers will be replaced by a new cornea from a donor. While in lamellar keratoblasty, it is a partial keratoblasty. Not all layers will be replaced, but certain layers. It is divided into two types, deep anterior lamellar keratoblasty, or what's called DALK, done by removing the corneal stroma down to distal membrane and replaced by a donor cornea by what's called big bubble technique. While the endothelial keratoblasty, the replacement occurs for distal membrane and corneal endothelium with or without a variable amount of corneal stroma. This is called DISC or DEMIC. Here, the changed layer is the endothelium and the distal membrane, not all the anterior layers, and occurred done mainly in cases of endothelial dysfunction. Angle of the anterior chamber. The angle of the anterior chamber is the part located between the cornea and the iris and contains the trabecular meshwork, which mainly responsible for drainage of aqueous humor. So, angle of the anterior chamber has a main role in case of glaucoma. Angle closure, glaucoma, is mainly caused by closure of the angle anatomically due to narrow angle. Why in open angle? The angle is open, but the blockage occurs at the level beyond the angle, at the trabecular meshwork itself. Lens. Lens, it is a biconvex transparent crystalline structure formed of anterior capsule, posterior capsule, and equator of the lens, and lined by cells, and contain nucleus and cortex. It is totally transparent, also due to lack of nerves, blood vessels, or connective tissue. So, we can define the cataract by clouding of the normal clear lens due to lens opacification. As regards anatomy, we can classify cataract into two different types: cortical cataracts with opacification in the cortex, nuclear cataract with opacification in the nucleus, anterior polar cataract with opacification as the anterior pole of the lens, posterior polar cataract in which the opacification in the posterior pole of the lens, and posterior subcapsular cataract in which the opacification at the level is below the posterior capsule. Vitreous. Vitreous, it is a clear gel, fills the space between the lens and the retina of the eyeball. It is firmly attached to aura serrata and optic disc, back of the lens, and foveal region. Pseudo vitreous detachment. It is a condition in which the vitreous membrane separates from the retina posterior to the vitreous base. Because of strong attachments at aura serrata and vitreous base, the vitreous still attached to this site while it separated from all retinal site, and what's called posterior vitreous detachment. Posterior vitreous detachment usually occur in old age and usually lead to nothing, but in some cases posterior vitreous detachment can proceed with adherent membrane which pull in the retina, and if the pulling is strong, it will lead to break and what is called retinal detachment. This is the end of my presentation, and I hope you enjoy it. Thank you.